Any clues as to what this might be? Stay tuned for the answer. My name is Samantha Corcoran, and I'm excited to share more about the geography, the history, and the culture of Esther at this year's Women Walking with God conference. You may remember Esther as the beautiful Jewish orphan who became queen, who, with assistance from her cousin Mordecai, saved the lives of their entire Jewish community in the 4th century BC by an evil plot from Haman. As a result from all of those events, Esther and Mordecai instituted a brand new Jewish feast called Purim. And Purim is supposed to help Jews remember these events and remember what God did to save his people. In fact, in Esther chapter 9, verse 28, it says, "These days should be remembered and observed in every generation by every family and in every province and in every city. And these days of Purim should never fail to be celebrated by the Jews, nor should the memory of these days die out among their descendants." While Jews today continue to celebrate Purim each year, there is another group of people who lay special claim to Esther. There is still a small group of Jews living in the same place where Esther and Mordecai lived 2,500 years ago. Esther lived in Susa in the Persian Empire, which today is in the country of Iran. You might be surprised to learn that Iran hosts the largest group of Jews outside of Israel in the Middle East. They are called Persian or Iranian Jews. They are descended from the Israelites in exile, just like Esther and Mordecai were. Iranian Jews are proud of their heritage and faithfully follow Esther and Mordecai's command to remember and observe Purim. As further testament to their dedication to God and His Word, they are the faithful caretakers of a very special site. This mausoleum is located in the city of Hamadan, in Iran. In antiquity, it was called Ekbatana, the summer palace residence of Persian royalty, the summer royal resort, if you will, which is about 200 miles west of the capital city, Tehran. It sits on a previous structure believed to be destroyed by the Mongols in the 14th century and renovated in the 1970s. Travelers wrote about this tomb as early as the 12th century AD. The mausoleum is built toward the west so that when you pray, you're praying toward Jerusalem. The walls are covered in Hebrew and Aramaic script, including things like the Ten Commandments. To enter, there is a small door that you have to bow down to enter in so that you automatically show respect when you enter. Each year, thousands of people make a pilgrimage to this mausoleum to pray, read the Book of Esther, and remember the deeds of two great Jewish heroes, Esther and Mordecai. This site is important to Jews, Muslims, and Christians alike. In fact, one journalist who visited said that Iranian Jews especially come by the busload. The fact that Iranian Jews and even their Muslim neighbors have been keeping Esther and Mordecai's story alive for over 2,500 years speaks to their faithfulness in sharing the story of how God worked through Esther and Mordecai to save his people. In the words of Esther 9:28, they are not letting the memory of these days die out among their descendants. Rather, they are living Psalm 145:4, which says of God, "One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts." What are some ways that you share God's mighty works with others? You may not be a queen with a kingdom, but you too can still share God's mighty works, whether it's from what you've read in the Bible or from your own life. The important thing is to share it with others so that God's mighty works and people learning about them can continue from generation to generation. Just like people still talk about Esther today, even 2,500 years later, and still remember her yearly, we need to share God's mighty works from generation to generation. So I hope you'll come join me on April 12th, because there is a lot more to learn about Esther, the Persian Empire, and how all of that impacts her story. And I can't wait to see you there.